Cheryl could not imagine it. Finally, after a long silence, she said, "Emma, I want to think about it." Emma naturally understood her thoughts. She nodded. "Okay, think about it carefully. I will always stay here and keep an eye on his situation." "Thank you, Emma," Cheryl thanked Emma. "What are you thanking me for?" "We're family." Cheryl and Emma chatted as they walked toward the treatment room. They did not notice that it was around the corner. Mary was waiting there. She initially thought that Gus remembered Cheryl, but she did not expect that the person Gus had forgotten was Cheryl. And now Emma found a way to treat Gus. But as long as Cheryl provoked Gus, would Gus remember her? No, that absolutely could not happen. Mary's eyes flashed with annoyance. Then she quickly went to find Fred. She told him about what she'd learned. Fred's face was dark as he said, "We can't let that woman agitate Gus. Otherwise, all our efforts in this time will have been in vain."
"Then what should we do?" Mary asked.
"We can use Karina. That woman stole Gus. She must be the most annoyed. She will definitely do something," Fred said.
"But Karina was arranged for Gus," Mary hesitated.
Fred said, "As long as we can use Karina, it will be the same outcome."
"Okay, I will go find Karina."
Gus did not know that Mary and Fred had already thought of Cheryl. At this time, he was listening to Emma talk about his situation. "When you have a headache, your brain starts recovering your memories. So, although I will stay here, I cannot always be by your side. So the best way is for Cheryl to stay by your side." Regarding Emma's request, Gus had no objections, but he worried Cheryl would not have time. "I have no problem, but she has to go to the medical school from Monday to Friday morning, right?"
"Then Mr. Monahan will go to class with you," Emma answered casually.
Cheryl hesitated. "That won't do." Gus frowned when he heard Cheryl's response. Could she be unwilling to let Bradley find out about their relationship? Gus was overthinking things. Bradley already knew about the relationship between you and her.
"Why not?" Emma asked.
"It will be boring for him to wait for me in class," Cheryl said. Gus expected Cheryl to immediately respond. He said, "It's okay, I can watch." Since Gus was willing, Cheryl had nothing to refuse. So the next day, when Cheryl went to the medical school for classes, she took Gus with her. Bradley was utterly stunned when she saw Cheryl and Gus appear in the advanced course. Just as he was about to greet Gus, Gus looked at him coldly. "You are Bradley."
"Huh?"
Bradley's jaw dropped when he heard what Gus said. What was going on? Gus thought he was wondering about his relationship with Cheryl when he saw Gus's shocked expression. So he pulled Cheryl into his arms and swore his sovereignty to Bradley. Bradley looked at Gus, and then he pulled Cheryl to the side. "What's wrong with him? Why is he acting weird?"
"He doesn't remember you," Cheryl replied.
"Are you kidding me?" Bradley thought Cheryl was joking. "I'm not joking. He lost his memory. He doesn't even remember me," Cheryl said seriously.
"Lost his memory? Even you don't remember?"
This time Bradley was even more frightened than before when Gus asked him if his name was Bradley.
"Yes," Cheryl nodded.
"That's why I met him eating with that girl in the restaurant. The reason why he didn't look for you was that he didn't remember you. So it wasn't because you two had a fight?" Bradley asked. Before Cheryl could answer, Gus walked over and pulled her into his arms. His expression was one of possessiveness. Bradley introduced himself to Gus.
"My name is Bradley. I'm Cheryl's teacher."
"Huh, she's mine," Gus replied. Bradley was speechless when he heard Gus's jealous words. It turned out that Gus's attitude towards him was the same as before. Not only possessiveness, but jealousy. Though he did feel a sense of accomplishment to be able to make Gus jealous. However, the things Gus did to him before made him feel misrepresented. Cheryl did not know that Gus and Bradley had a tempestuous relationship. She was frowning at the moment and looking at the others in the classroom. Specifically,
She was looking at the other women. Last time, in order to save Cheryl's pride, Gus had Benny drive 12 luxury cars to Farm Entertainment. Everyone knew that Gus was wealthy. The way they looked at Gus was very flirtatious. They really wanted to run over and drag Gus away. Cheryl really regretted it. Back then, why did she let her temper get the better of her? Then, if a woman said that she was poor, she never cared. She let Gus vent his anger on her. In the end, Gus was now a hot potato. In front of her, there were all sorts of seductive eyes on Gus. The more Cheryl thought about it, the more unhappy she became. Finally, she said to Gus, "Go to the car and wait for me."
"What's wrong?"
Gus raised his eyebrows. He was not very willing. "It's too noisy here. Go to the car and rest for a while. I will look for you after class." Cheryl's voice was very soft, with a hint of pleading, "Gus." Gus was quite satisfied. His purpose in coming here was actually to see Bradley. Just now, he had warned Bradley off, so he agreed to return to the car. Seeing Gus leave, the classroom was filled with disappointed eyes. Cheryl lifted her chin proudly. He was not for their prying eyes. Bradley stood on the podium and looked at Cheryl's proud expression. He rolled his eyes. This couple was really enough. After her class ended, Cheryl immediately packed her things and rushed out. Bradley called after her but needed to be faster. He could only watch as she ran out of the classroom. He had lost his memory. Did she need to be in such a hurry? When Cheryl got to Gus's car, Gus was sleeping with his eyes closed. "Miss Cheryl, Mr. Monahan is asleep." "Shh." Cheryl made a shushing gesture and quietly sat beside Gus. Todd nodded and started the car. Less than 5 minutes later, Gus's phone rang. Gus, who had been sleeping, immediately opened his eyes. A cold light flashed in his eyes. When he saw that the person sitting next to him was Cheryl, the coldness in his eyes instantly disappeared. Then he took out his phone from his pocket and asked, "When did you get in the car? Why didn't you call me?"
"I just got in and saw that you were asleep, so I didn't want to wake you," Cheryl replied.
Gus nodded, then he slid the phone to his ear. "Mr. Monahan, the Rogue family has canceled their cooperation with us this morning."
"The Rogue family? Karina?"
A cold light flashed in Gus's eyes. Was she planning to use the Rogue family to pressure him? Then he would let her know how stupid her decision was. With a cold glint in his eyes, Gus asked,
"Is there a shortage of funds?"
"They're blocked." He paused for a moment. Benny paused for a second. "We need to find another partner."
"Yes, contact Chris. I will talk to him about the details."
LM Group was involved in various industries. Back then, the Monahan family collaborated with the Rogue family because they were an old family acquaintance. Furthermore, the Rogue family had supported the Monahan family for many years. In fact, the LM Group, established by John, was the best choice. However, for many years, the Rogue family had always supported the Monahan family. Therefore, Gus gave this opportunity to them. In any case, the LM Corporation had the funds and status to pick up the slack. Now, since the Rogue family had canceled the cooperation, he would directly hand it over to the LM Group. Currently, the LM Corporation was being run by Chris. Therefore, Gus asked Benny to contact Chris for him.
"Yes, Mr. Monahan."
Gus hung up the phone. When Gus hung up the phone, Cheryl immediately asked, "Did you just say there was a shortage of funds? Did something happen to the company?"
"A little problem that is quite easy to solve. But..."
Gus looked at Cheryl hesitantly. Cheryl was stunned for a few seconds before she reacted. Gus was going to the company. If it was any other time, Cheryl would definitely not agree to let Gus go to the company. What he needed the most right now was recuperation. However, if there was a problem, Gus had to go and deal with it. So in the end, Cheryl agreed. However, she also raised her conditions. Finish dealing with the problem quickly and go back home.
Okay. Gus brought Cheryl to Landis Corp. Before, when Gus brought Karina to the company, everyone in the company was talking about her. In the end, it had not even been 3 days before they saw him bringing Cheryl to the company again. Everyone in the company was in an uproar. As for the people on the office of president floor, they were all the same, as expected. Cheryl had a puzzled look on her face. After arriving at Gus's office, Gus prepared to ask his secretary to order lunch for Cheryl. "Aren't you in a hurry to go to the meeting? Why are you ordering me food?" "You eat," Gus said. Cheryl shook her head and refused. "No, I want to wait for you to eat." "Aren't you hungry?" Gus looked at Cheryl's lower abdomen and asked. "No," Cheryl said. "Okay," Gus agreed reluctantly. Then he called his secretary. He asked his secretary to prepare snacks and fruit for Cheryl. Finally, Gus said, "If you are bored, play with my computer." "I know. Go to the meeting quickly," Cheryl said. Gus then left the office. The moment Gus left, the secretary said, "Miss Cheryl, congratulations to you." "Congratulations for what?" Cheryl looked confused. "Congratulations on defeating your rival," the secretary replied. "Who?" Cheryl was still at a loss. "That Karina woman," the secretary said. When she heard the secretary's words, Cheryl did not know whether to laugh or cry. Did he bring Karina to the company? A few days ago, Karina and Mr. Monahan came to the company. There was a pause. The secretary said, "Miss Cheryl, don't misunderstand. Mr. Monahan was always very cold to her. It is completely different from how he treats you." "What is completely different?" Cheryl raised her eyebrows in confusion. The secretary pointed to the snacks and computer in front of Cheryl and said, "Mr. Monahan treats you well. He has food, drink, and play. He has prepared things for you to do. As for Karina, when she came with Mr. Monahan, she can only sit on the cold bench." Actually, Cheryl herself knew very well that Gus treated her differently. However, she only needed to think about how Gus remembered everyone but forgot about her, and she still felt uncomfortable. Now, when she heard what the secretary said, it reminded her. Still, she was delighted to be treated differently. "I see. So, Miss Cheryl, you must work hard to stay on top," said the secretary encouragingly. Cheryl did not know whether to laugh or cry. "I will work hard. Thank you." Gus did not know that Cheryl was carrying the expectations of the office of the president's secretarial department. At this time, he was talking to Chris about the new cooperation agreement. "Benny already told you about the cooperation. I have asked my secretary to drop the contract." Chris finished the video and asked, "What's going on with the Rogue family? They're going to be stuck on the outside looking in, so why would they want to cancel their cooperation with the Monahan family?" "They probably want to pressure me," Gus replied indifferently. "Do you want me to get rid of them?" Chris raised his eyebrows when he heard Gus's words. "No, I will deal with them myself," Gus said. Chris nodded. He suddenly remembered something and asked, "I heard from Mr. Grant that you lost a part of your memory." "Yes," Gus nodded, and then asked, "Queenie doesn't know, right?" "She is pregnant, so we kept it from her. Otherwise, she would have run over to find you." When Chris talked about Queenie, there was a trace of love on his stoic face. "Yes, don't let her know. Those two are up to no good over here for the time being." Mary and Fred were on his side, so he could not let Queenie arrive to drip water. "They came over?" he asked with a surprised expression. Although Gus did not say who those two were, Chris instantly understood. "It has to do with the Rogue family. They're trying to claw their way inside," Gus said. "I understand. I won't let her know," Chris said. "Good." The LM Consortium and the Monahan family were originally one family. Therefore, Gus and Chris quickly came to an agreement. Then he returned to his office. In the office, Cheryl was using the computer to watch TV. Gus walked over, but Cheryl did not notice him. After a long while, Cheryl finally saw Gus. She immediately asked in shock, "When did you get back?"
"I came back a while ago," Gus said.
"Why didn't you call me?" Cheryl pouted.
"I saw that you were distracted," Gus said.
"No," Cheryl pouted and asked. "Are you sure?" "Oh, right. Did you change your computer?"
Hearing Cheryl's words, Gus turned around and looked at her.
How did she know? Didn't he have all the data restored?
"Didn't you change it? All the saved data from my games is gone."
Gus's heart skipped a beat when he heard Cheryl's words. How could he forget about this? But of course, Gus would not tell Cheryl that he had thrown the computer before. He said,
"Maybe there's something wrong with the computer."
Cheryl did not doubt Gus's words at all. Instead, she nodded and said, "All right."
Gus said, "Are you hungry? Let's go eat."
"Sure." Cheryl was indeed hungry. Initially, when she came out of medical school, she should have had lunch, but Gus rushed to a meeting. He went to the company first. He had asked his secretary to prepare lunch for Cheryl. However, Cheryl turned it down. She wanted to eat with Gus, so she only ate some snacks.
"Where do you want to eat?" Gus asked as he closed the computer and put it in his computer bag.
"Hell's Barbecue?" Cheryl replied.
"Brisket?" Gus subconsciously looked at Cheryl after he finished speaking.
"Yes, we eat there often," Cheryl said with the bag in her hand.
Gus nodded and put the computer into his bag.
Cheryl asked curiously, "Why did you put the computer in the bag? Don't we have a computer at home?"
Gus had a computer in the study. He had given her a new one. When she packed her things and left the villa, she did not take it with her.
"Gus, why did you want her to bring the computer back?"
Hearing Cheryl's words, Gus's action of loading the computer froze for a moment and then answered, "There is something important on this computer. I need to take it home with me."
"Oh," Cheryl nodded.
She reached for the laptop bag in Gus's hand and was dodged by Gus.
"I'll take it."
Finally, the two of them walked out of the office shoulder to shoulder. After coming out of the company, they went to Hal's for lunch. Cheryl and Gus happily ate lunch together. Meanwhile, back at the house, Karina could not sit still. Last night, Mary told her that Emma found a way to help Gus recover his memory. It was to let Cheryl agitate Gus. When she heard it, she was highly anxious. She wanted to find Gus. However, Todd stopped her and wouldn't let Gus see her. She thought about it and finally called her father. Her family had always supported the Monahan family and had always cooperated with Gus. She wanted his family to put pressure on Gus. She wanted Gus to marry her. Her father had always wanted her to be with Gus. If the two families worked together, they would gain more benefits. Therefore, he immediately agreed to her request. Half a day passed. Logically speaking, her father and Gus had already proposed to cancel the cooperation. So, why hadn't Gus reacted yet? No rush. He would definitely compromise. Right now, he was probably busy trying to think of a way. However, his father had said that with such a massive shortage of funds and such a colossal cancellation of cooperation, even if Gus was a member of the Monahan family or the sect master of the Dragon Gate, he would not be able to find a way out. Therefore, she wasn't in a hurry. She just needed to wait. Karina told herself that again and again. She waited until 2 p.m. Gus returned to the house. Cheryl was with him. Karina hated Cheryl very much, but she did not show it. Instead, she smiled and went up to greet Gus.
"Gus, you're back!"
Gus did not say anything. Instead, he said to Cheryl, "Go back to your room first." Cheryl did not hesitate when she heard Gus's words. She nodded and said, "Okay." But in Karina's eyes, it was full of ridicule. Cheryl carried on behind her back like this. This woman was not afraid. What had happened between her and Gus? Was she too confident or was she too stupid? She did not know that Gus had just finished telling Cheryl that he hated Karina.
Therefore, Cheryl was not jealous at all. Instead, when she saw Karina's expression, she shook her head. Then Cheryl took the computer bag from Gus's hand and went straight into the master bedroom. After watching Cheryl leave, Gus said indifferently, "Just say what you need to say." Karina did not notice anything wrong. She said happily, "Gus, is your company okay?"
"What do you think?" Gus asked.
"I heard that the Rogue family is going to cancel their cooperation with you. That's why I asked," Karina said with a face full of charm. Gus said lightly, "Didn't you ask the Rogue family to cancel their cooperation with me?"
Karina's eyes widened when she heard Gus's words. "You, how did you know?"
Gus did not answer Karina's words. Instead, he just looked at her coldly. Karina was flustered by his gaze. She explained to Gus, "Gus, don't misunderstand. I'm not really going to make the Rogue family cancel their cooperation with you. I just want you to marry me. As long as you agree to marry me, we will immediately resume our cooperation with you."
Gus's face was expressionless as he said lightly, "No one has ever dared to threaten me."
Hearing Gus's words, Karina pulled him back in a panic. "No, Gus, don't be angry. Don't be angry. I just want to love you. I have no other intentions."
Gus shook off Karina's hand and said coldly, "The Rogue family will pay for your willfulness."
After saying this, Gus left. Karina fell to the ground in despair. No, he would not. She would not.
When Gus entered the master bedroom, Cheryl was opening the wardrobe and looking for something.
"What are you looking for?" Gus asked.
"I'm looking for my clothes. I want to take a bath."
Cheryl could not stand the fact that she did not take a bath last night.
"I don't think I have any clothes here, though. I will call Benny and ask him to bring some clothes over."
"Don't bother. I'll go back to the apartment tomorrow."
"Go back?"
Gus stared at Cheryl.
To get clothes," Cheryl said.
"Let Benny get them," Gus said domineeringly.
Well, he had returned to his domineering attitude. Cheryl rolled her eyes.
"I'll get the maids to prepare it for me. Then I'll ask Todd to go and get it. Is that okay?"
"Yes." This time, Gus was satisfied. Cheryl said,
"You went out for half a day today and rested for a while. I will look for my Emma and ask her to check on you."
"No need, I'm fine," Gus said.
"You..." Cheryl wanted to say something. Gus said,
"Didn't you want to take an afternoon nap?"
Cheryl was speechless. In the end, Cheryl obediently took an afternoon nap. After she fell asleep, Gus got up. Then he took out the laptop from his computer bag. He then sat on the bed and turned on the laptop. He clicked on the game software. Cheryl was in a daze as she slept. She could feel the light beside her. She looked at Gus holding his laptop in a daze and frowned. She did not know what he was doing. Didn't he say he was sleeping? Why did he go back to work? Cheryl thought Gus was busy with work. Although she was curious, she did not say anything. She turned around and continued to sleep. When Cheryl woke up from her afternoon nap, Gus was still working on the computer.
"Why are you still working?" Cheryl sat up and looked at the computer in Gus's hands.
Gus moved the computer away quickly.
"It's ready."
As he spoke, he pressed a few buttons on the computer and it turned off. Cheryl felt that Gus's behavior was a little strange, as if he was hiding something. Could it be that he was afraid that she would say that he was too busy working? It was not until the next day did Cheryl find out why Gus did not let her look at his laptop. The next Saturday, Cheryl did not need to go to the medical college for classes and accompanied Gus to Landis Corps. Gus then busied himself with reading the documents. Cheryl sat next to him and read magazines. After reading for a while, Gus was afraid that she would be bored, so he gave her the computer to watch TV. Cheryl looked around and did not see the TV she wanted to watch. She clicked on the game software. She planned to play the saved game. In the end, she turned on the game and miraculously found a record in the game that was empty yesterday. Ah, what's going on?
Cheryl's exclamation startled Gus. He raised his head and looked over. What's wrong?
My game didn't have a record yesterday. I can't believe it's back today, Cheryl replied.
Oh, Gus said. Then he said, there was no record yesterday. It was probably a problem with the computer's data. The data must have been restored today.
Is that so? Then why isn't the record recovered to the progress that I played previously?
Cheryl asked. Gus's expression froze when he heard Cheryl's words. He then replied, roughly.
Will the data recovery suddenly surpass my game progress?
Cheryl looked at Gus without blinking and asked,
so do you want to tell me what's going on?
Gus still wanted to hold on. I don't know.
Don't know. The last time it was logged in was 4 o'clock yesterday afternoon, Cheryl said quietly.
Well, now the evidence was complete. Cheryl really did not expect that yesterday. Gus had specially brought the laptop back to restore her game progress. It was only because she said that some of the data was gone. Then he took advantage of her afternoon nap to help her restore the game progress. From her impression, Gus never played games, but for her, he spent an entire afternoon playing this game.
Gus touched his nose and said, I threw the computer earlier and felt bad about you losing the data.
That's why there's no record of the game, Cheryl asked.
Yes, Gus nodded.
If not, then so be it. Do you need to spend the whole afternoon playing with this? Are you stupid? Cheryl asked.
The reason I broke the computer back then was because I saw a picture of you on the screen and panicked.
That's why. Gus did not finish his sentence. Cheryl interrupted.
I understand.
At that time, Gus had just woken up. He was very frustrated by her. As long as it was related to her, he was not happy, so he threw the computer. Even so, Cheryl did not blame him. He had forgotten her, and it was not his intention.
Gus was silent. As more and more of his feelings gradually recovered, he felt that what he had done to her before was way too much.
Cheryl smiled and said, when you remember me, I will settle the score with you.
Okay, Gus agreed. Gus had an important meeting this morning. He could not be absent. Therefore, he did not go to medical school with Cheryl. After Cheryl finished her morning class, she looked at the time on her phone. It was already 11:30. Gus's meeting seemed to end at 11:45. She had to get a taxi early so he wouldn't wait too long. With that in mind, Cheryl quickly packed her things and hurried out of the medical college. When she was taking a taxi not far from the entrance of the medical college, Cheryl saw Karina. Didn't Karina move out of the house a few days ago? Didn't she leave the capital? Why was she here? Of course, Cheryl would not run over to ask Karina this question. Karina was her rival, after all. After Karina talked with Gus, she received a call from her father. Gus had already found other partners, and her family now encountered an unprecedented crisis. Karina originally wanted to return to Canada directly, but she was still a little unwilling, so she stayed. Then she specially waited in the medical college today. Although Cheryl had turned her gaze away and pretended not to see her, Karina still went over.
Cheryl?
Since Karina had already opened her mouth, Cheryl naturally could not continue pretending not to see her. She turned her head and asked, are you looking for me for something? Karina's slightly swollen face turned towards Cheryl.
I want to talk to you about Gus.
Cheryl frowned. There's nothing to talk about between you and me. She was ready to leave. However, Karina's words made her stop.
Don't you want to know about his past?
Cheryl liked Gus. She wanted to know everything about Gus. She did not know Gus's past. Therefore, she and Karina got in the car. Karina took Cheryl to a hotel suite. Then she called Cheryl to sit and asked,
what do you want to drink?
I can't. Cheryl shook her head.
Are you afraid that I will harm you? Karina did not force it and only asked with a smile.
Cheryl's expression was a little embarrassed. She was indeed afraid that Karina would harm her. After all, she was not alone right now. In her womb was Gus's child.
Since you moved out of the house, is this where you're living now?
Cheryl looked around this ordinary suite.
With Karina's identity, she should be living more lavishly, right? At least it should be the presidential suite.
Karina smiled bitterly and said,
Do you think I should not stay in this kind of suite?
Cheryl smiled and did not say anything. Karina said,
The family is going to go bankrupt. There's not much money left for me to squander.
Hearing Karina's words, Cheryl was stunned.
How could that be?
Because I wanted to force Gus to marry me. I asked my family to cancel our cooperation with him. I did not expect that not only did I fail, but it would also force my family into a desperate situation, Karina replied.
Cheryl did not expect that reply. For a moment, she did not know what to say.
My family has always been familiar with his family. I've admired him since I was young. I always thought that, other than me, no one was worthy of him. With my family, he'd have a lot of benefits. His parents approve, but he doesn't like me and won't even let me get close to him. The last time I came to DC, I saw him act in a way I've never seen before. He was so gentle toward you. But then he sent me back to Germany. I had given up. But again, I was told to come back to see him and care for him when he was injured. When I got here, it seemed like we may have a chance. I started to have hope. I thought he had forgotten about you, so I didn't want you to reappear. But I can't stop you. You still came back. You are still special in his heart, Karina said. Karina's words made her seem less hateful to Cheryl. She was just a woman who deeply loved Gus but could not obtain Gus's love.
I didn't call you over to gain your sympathy, Karina said. I want to give it one last try.
Try what? Cheryl asked doubtfully.
Karina did not answer Cheryl's question. Instead, she took her phone from her pocket and dialed a number.
It was almost noon when Gus came out of the conference room. He looked at the time and asked Todd, Is she here?
Cheryl is not here yet, Todd replied.
Gus nodded. Then he asked, Have you told the desk?
Yes, when Cheryl is here, the front desk will send her up, Todd said.
Gus was satisfied by Todd's confirmation. The day before yesterday, when he went to Hal's barbecue with Cheryl, he had seen how much she loved brisket, so he specifically asked Todd to order the same to send to the office. Gus nodded and walked to the office. He had just taken two steps when his phone rang. He took out his phone from his pocket. Karina's name showed up on his home screen. He thought that she had already returned to Germany, but the number on the phone was her U.S. phone number. Frowning slightly, Gus pressed the answer button. Hello?
Gus, it's me, Karina said.
What is it? Gus asked coldly.
And how are you? Can't I call you?
Karina sounded a little bitter. In Gus's heart, there was not a single ripple. No.
You really are heartless,
Karina said. Gus didn't respond. Heartless, cold, he had heard enough. He didn't care at all. However, Karina's next sentence made him instantly fly into a rage.
I wonder if you are also so heartless to Cheryl.
What does Cheryl have to do with anything? Todd had joined Gus in the office, and Gus gestured to him to call Cheryl.
Gus, you're a smart guy. You should have figured this out,
Karina said. And then she answered Cheryl's phone as Todd called. Karina had Cheryl's phone. Gus could not get through. She's with you, Gus said.
Yes,
Karina replied.
I have her.
What do you need from me? Let her go. Gus tightened his fingers on the phone and asked.
You'll know when you come,
Karina said. Okay, I will come. Where are you guys now? Gus said. He took a deep breath and tried his best to calm down.
At the Washington Hotel, room 101. Come Come here alone in half an hour. If you don't come alone, or if you don't come on time, then she will...
Karina did not finish her sentence. Gus understood what she meant. He replied with one word, "Okay," and then cut off the phone. He turned around and walked toward the elevator. "Gus, what happened?" Todd followed him. "Karina has Cheryl," Gus replied. Gus kept walking. Todd was shocked to hear Gus's words. He said, "I will go with you." Gus shook his head. "No, Karina said I needed to come alone." But Todd still wanted to say something. Gus interrupted him. "Don't follow me." With that, he went straight to the elevator. Todd had no choice but to go look for Benny. Cheryl knew that Karina had called Gus, and based on what she heard, Karina said she was kidnapping her. She did not understand what Gus said, but she could roughly guess from Karina's words. Seeing Karina hang up the phone with a gloomy expression, Cheryl sighed. "Why are you doing this?" "If I don't do this, I won't be satisfied." Karina smiled bitterly. Cheryl shook her head and said, "But you are going to be disappointed." "Are you so sure?" "Don't forget that he has lost all of his memories related to you," Karina replied. Cheryl shook her head. "Even if he has lost his memories and is unfamiliar to me, he still knows I'm important to him somehow." "More important than his life?" Karina did not believe it. "Yes, more important than his life." Cheryl paused momentarily and said, "Do you know why he lost his memory?" "I only heard that he was injured and his brain was damaged. I'm not sure about the rest," Karina replied. Cheryl said, "He was injured because of me. A car drove toward me and he tried to help." Karina's mouth was wide open in shock. "He loves you very much," Karina said. "Love me?" "I don't know. He loves someone and I don't know if it's me," Cheryl said. "Who else could he love?" Karina said. Her eyes were filled with disbelief, but before she could finish speaking, a loud bang came from the direction of the door. Cheryl and Karina heard the sound and turned around. They saw the door was kicked open and Gus rushed in from outside. He looked at Cheryl to ensure she was okay and grabbed Karina's neck. "Let go of her," Cheryl said. Gus did not move. He tightened his grip on Karina's neck. Karina's face became paler and paler. Cheryl became anxious. She tried her best to pull Gus away. "She did not kidnap me. She only talked with me for a while. Quickly, let go of her. Let go." Gus was indifferent. Cheryl cried out. When Gus heard her cry out, he immediately let go of Karina. Then he asked nervously, "What's wrong?" "I'm fine. She didn't do anything to me. Don't be angry." After Cheryl finished speaking, she turned to look at Karina. "Karina, are you okay?" Karina did not say anything. Instead, she just rubbed her neck and shook her head. At that moment, she really felt that Gus wanted to kill her, and she gave up, ultimately. But Gus had calmed down and returned to his senses. He understood that something odd was going on. If Karina really kidnapped Cheryl, then why did Cheryl cry out when he grabbed Karina? He asked, "What exactly is going on?" "Karina wanted to test you," Cheryl said, "to see what was in your heart." He recalled the moment he heard that Cheryl had been kidnapped by Karina. It felt as if all the blood in his body froze. He sped to the hotel and ran countless red lights. His mind was full of thoughts. If something happened to her, what would he do? He didn't even remember her. And all of this was just a joke. Gus felt a familiar and intense pain in his head. He raised his hand and held his head. "Oh, it hurts. Cheryl." Gus suddenly grabbed Cheryl's hand and shouted hoarsely and painfully. Karina was surprised by Gus's sudden situation. Cheryl quickly hugged him. "I'm here. I am here. Don't think about it. Don't think about it." However, Gus could not hear her words at all. Instead, a scene flashed through his mind. A car drove toward Cheryl.
He desperately shouted for her to get out of the way, but she only turned around and did not get out of the way. He saw that the car was getting closer and closer to her. No, Cheryl! He desperately wanted to rush forward, but Cheryl turned into a shadow in front of him. In despair, Gus heard a voice. Gus, wake up! Why was this voice so familiar? This is Cheryl's voice. Gus shouted Cheryl's name and suddenly opened his eyes. His chest rose and fell rapidly, and his mind was cloudy. Cheryl's voice had helped him come back to his senses. You're awake. Gus turned his head and saw Cheryl holding his hand. Her face was full of tears. Emma was checking his head. How do you feel? Emma asked after staring at Gus for a few seconds. Gus turned his gaze from Cheryl to Emma. I saw something, Gus replied. What is it? Emma was surprised when she heard Gus's words. Cheryl's heart ached. He looked at her, but did not say anything. Emma understood that he did not want to speak in front of Cheryl. Cheryl, you can go out for a while, she said. Cheryl nodded and then walked out of the room. Tell me, what did you see? Emma asked after Cheryl left. I saw her standing on the cruise ship, and she said something to me. I didn't hear it clearly. She looked at me and jumped off the cruise ship. Gus frowned slightly and said, She seems to have bandages on her right hand. Bandages. Hearing Gus's words, Emma was very sure that when he had a headache, he thought of the scene that was actually part of his memory. Did I imagine this? Gus asked. Emma shook her head. No. It's true. Gus was shocked. Did no one tell you about you and Cheryl? That's true. You always rejected her. Why would you want to know about what happened between you and her? Emma said snappily. Gus frowned. Emma rolled her eyes and said, 3 months ago, someone kidnapped me, Wendy, and Cheryl. Then you received a call from the kidnapper and went to save us. At that time, the kidnapper asked you to choose who to save. You chose Wendy and me. Gus suddenly felt as if he was suffocating. A wave of pain spread through his heart. The kidnapper wanted Aiden's life in exchange for Cheryl's life, Emma continued. So Cheryl chose to jump off the ship. She almost died, and when she woke up, she suggested a divorce. Gus really did not expect that things would be like this. He thought it was an illusion, but it was the truth. And the reality was far more uncomfortable than the illusion. He had chosen Emma and Wendy, not Cheryl. So Cheryl had jumped off the ship so Aiden wouldn't exchange his life for her. And she had almost died. And then they were divorced. When he woke up, they told him that she was his wife. He refused to admit it. Then when he learned they were divorced and chased her away, what did he do? What did he do to her? Emma saw Gus's ugly expression and knew he was probably thinking about what had happened back then. Even if he did not have any memories, he still felt pain for Cheryl. Gus suddenly thought of something and asked, What's the matter with the bandage on her right hand? The person who attacked you wanted to snatch Wendy, and when Cheryl saved her, her hand was broken, Emma said. You asked Aiden for Dr. Lee's contact information and sent the medical records to discuss treatment, but because she's pregnant, nothing came of it. Sure enough, he sometimes felt that Cheryl's right hand was a little strange. Gus's brow was furrowed, and his expression was grim. Emma looked at him and then said, Now, tell me what you thought of today. Hearing Emma's words, Gus again thought of the scene that came to his mind today. He thought it was an illusion and did not feel anything. Now that he knew it was real, his heart palpitated. After a long silence, Gus said, I saw a car approaching her. I desperately shouted for her to get out of the way, but she didn't hear me. Then I watched helplessly as the car got closer and closer to her. Closer and closer. Did it hit her? Gus asked excitedly. No, Emma shook her head. This memory is of your car accident. When you saw the car approaching her, you drove and hit the car. Then you lost your memory. Gus let out a sigh of relief. It turned out that she was more important than his life. He would have died for her in that moment. Cheryl did not know what Gus and Emma were discussing in the room. After she came out of Gus's room, she saw Karina pacing in the corridor. Karina, she immediately called out to her. Karina heard Cheryl's voice and turned her head. Seeing that it was Cheryl, she quickly rushed over. How is he? Is he okay? He's fine, Cheryl said. Karina heaved a sigh of relief and said, That's good. I was scared to death just now. Cheryl didn't reply. She stood quietly. Karina asked, Why did he suddenly become like this? Something provoked him, Cheryl replied. Karina suddenly thought of something and asked, Because of you, his memory was recovered. Cheryl felt that Karina's comment was strange. How did she know that she impacted Gus's memory? Of course she did not ask, she just nodded. Karina replied, Does this mean he will remember all his lost memories? That's possible, Cheryl said. Karina nodded. Cheryl asked, What are you going to do? What else can we do? I'm going back to Germany, Karina answered matter-of-factly. Cheryl did not expect Karina to be so straightforward. She was going to leave immediately. It's an hour drive from his office to the hotel. I gave him half an hour. In the end, he arrived in less than 20 minutes. Plus, his memory is returning. He may remember everything tomorrow. What should I do? She asked. Cheryl did not know how to comfort Karina. Karina said, This time I really give up. I will let him go. I cannot keep hanging on to him. Cheryl was speechless. She originally wanted to comfort her, but she didn't make a move. She let Karina leave. She stayed outside until Emma came out of the room. When Emma emerged, she immediately went over to greet her. How is he? Cheryl asked. When he had a headache, he saw some memories, Emma said. Really? Cheryl was very surprised. Yes, he saw when you were kidnapped and you jumped off the ship. And then he saw the car rushing toward you when he was in the car accident, Emma said. Cheryl was shocked. He opened her mouth wide. When he has a headache, he will remember some scenes, Emma said. But he's in so much pain, Cheryl frowned. If he does not remember, then he will always be in pain. Emma paused for a moment and said, With more pain and stimulation, he will remember more. Cheryl clenched her fists and made up her mind. I have a plan, she said, and began to speak. After Emma heard Cheryl's plan, her brows wrinkled. This won't do. If it doesn't work, you will get hurt, Emma said. If there isn't pain, it won't work, Cheryl said. No. No! In the end, Cheryl and Emma were unable to come to a conclusion. Gus heard the sound and came out of the room. What are you two arguing about? Cheryl and Emma looked at each other. I just wanted to order some takeout, but Emma won't let me, Cheryl said. Your body is different now. You need to eat less spicy food and eat more bland food, Emma said. I know, Cheryl pouted and replied. Gus remembered that he and Cheryl had not had lunch yet. Just eat a little less of the spicy food, Emma said. I have to leave now. After Emma left, Cheryl and Gus ordered takeout. When they were waiting for the food to come, Cheryl suddenly thought of something. By the way, I want to ask you something, she said. Go ahead, Gus replied. Did you do what Karina's family wanted you to? Cheryl asked. Gus hummed, then he asked, What's wrong? You should let them go without issue, especially Karina. She likes you too much, Cheryl said. Gus looked at her but did not say anything. Only then did Cheryl remember. Gus probably did not remember what he had done to her family, or what he would have done in the past. She quickly said, "Sorry, I did not mean to interfere."
"It's okay." Gus paused for a few seconds and said, "It's just a lesson for her family. It won't be too serious."
Cheryl felt relieved and said, "Karina has returned to Germany."
"Is that so?"
Gus raised his eyebrows. Cheryl nodded. She wanted to say something else.
At this moment, the doorbell rang. "It should be takeout. I'll go out and get it," Gus stood up and said.
Cheryl pulled him back. "You don't feel well. I'll go get it." Without waiting for Gus's response, she got up and went to open the door. She returned with the takeout. They sat in front of the coffee table and started to eat lunch. While Cheryl and Gus were eating takeout, Mary Monahan and Fred Tracy had heard the news that Karina had left the capital and returned to Germany.
"Oh, this Karina is really useless," Mary said angrily.
Fred said, "I heard that Gus put too much pressure on her. She needed to leave."
"Trash,"
Mary said with disdain, and then asked, "What should we do now? Let Gus recover his memory?"
"As long as we catch that woman, Gus will listen to us," Fred said.
"That woman seems to be very important to Gus. Will he get angry if we catch her?" Mary asked.
"That woman is important to him when he has his memories. But right now, he doesn't have memories of her," Fred said.
"It's your own son. You should know what kind of person he is."
Mary realized they needed another person to replace Karina. When Cheryl realized how to provoke Gus, she wanted to take action. It would be better if Gus saw her injured. Emma's idea was to act in front of Gus, but Cheryl felt that acting was not realistic. Even if Gus was really provoked, it was not enough. Emma felt that Cheryl's plan was too risky. Even if Gus recovered his memory, it would be terrible if Cheryl was injured. The two of them could not come to a unanimous decision. But, unexpectedly, Mary and Fred made a move against Cheryl and put this plan into action. That day, Cheryl accompanied Gus to work at the company. Suddenly, her phone rang. She was afraid of disturbing Gus, so she held her phone and walked out of the office. Gus heard the noise and looked up at her.
"Where are you going?"
"I'm going outside to answer the phone," Cheryl said.
"What phone call? Can't you answer it in front of me? Is that Bradley? Or is that Paul?"
Cheryl rolled her eyes. "Didn't I already tell you that they aren't worth worrying about?"
"Well, they're men, so that won't do," Gus said.
Before Gus lost his memory, he was jealous, but he didn't dare to show it. Cheryl was speechless. She raised her phone in front of Gus and said, "It's Sophie." Gus was embarrassed. Cheryl did not care about his embarrassment. "I'm going to answer the phone," she said. She did not wait for Gus's reply. She picked up the phone and left the office. Sophie called Cheryl about the heating at Maple Court. The owner had asked to come check the apartment, but Cheryl was not there. Sophie asked if she could let him into the apartment, and Cheryl said that was fine.
"Okay, I will open the door,"
Sophie said.
"When are you going back to the apartment?"
"I'm not sure." Although she and Emma had discussed a plan to provoke Gus, Cheryl wasn't sure if it was going to work.
"Take good care of yourself," Sophie said.
"I will," Cheryl said. She hung up the phone and she was about to return to Gus's office when she heard someone talking nearby. Usually she wouldn't eavesdrop, but she heard her name. Cheryl stopped and listened carefully. Todd's voice was filled with anxiety. "Should we ask Gus about Rachel?"
"Gus has lost his memory. We can't tell him," Benny said.
"We can avoid telling Gus about what Rachel did to Cheryl.
We can just tell him that Rachel was the culprit," Benny said.
Todd asked, "What do you think?"
Benny did not answer Todd's question.
"I don't know if it will work. Gus might suspect that something is up," Todd said.
"Well, then why are you suggesting it?" Benny asked. Todd was embarrassed. "I was worried."
Benny sighed and said, "We'll see when the time comes."
"Yes, I'll go back to Gus's office first,"
Todd nodded and said.
"Go."
Before Benny could say the word go,
he saw Cheryl standing not far away and looking at them.
Cheryl!
When Todd heard Benny call Cheryl, he also looked over and saw her watching them.
Cheryl, why are you here? He said.
Cheryl did not say anything and just looked at them. Could it be that Cheryl heard what they just said? Benny and Todd looked at each other, and then Cheryl spoke.
What happened to Rachel? Why did you arrest her?
Benny and Todd only had one thought when they heard Cheryl's questions.
It was over. Cheryl had heard everything. What should they do?
Todd turned around and looked at Benny questioningly. Benny laughed and asked Cheryl,
"Why are you not in Gus's office?"
"I came out to answer the phone," Cheryl replied.
"I see. Then Todd and I have something to do. See you later," he said quickly.
Benny and Todd turned away. But would Cheryl let them go?
"Of course not. It's fine if you don't tell me. I'll get Gus to ask you later," she said as they turned away.
When Benny and Todd heard these words, they instantly stopped in their tracks. If Cheryl really asked Gus to interrogate them, this would become even more serious.
Benny said, "Cheryl, don't ask him."
"Are you guys willing to tell me?"
Cheryl raised her eyebrows.
Benny and Todd nodded obediently.
"Then tell me," Cheryl said.
Benny glanced at Todd. He wanted to cry. Todd looked back at him.
What should he do? Should he speak or not?
Now, apart from telling her, they had no other way out. Todd explained the situation and how Rachel had caused so much trouble with the Vincent and Doyle families. Cheryl really did not expect to hear all these details and that Rachel caused many things to happen. But Todd's explanation left her with a question. If Rachel used Sue and Sue was trying to take revenge for Jenna, where was Jenna?
What happened to Jenna? Why did Sue want to kill me to avenge her? She asked.
Todd did not expect Cheryl to focus on this part of the issue. He realized he may have said too much.
I don't know. Cheryl, you have to ask Benny, he said.
Benny secretly cursed Todd, then said to Cheryl with a smile,
Cheryl, you should remember Mark Vincent's banquet you and Gus attended.
I remember, Cheryl nodded and then asked, is it related to that? Benny started talking about how Jenna got into trouble with Cheryl when Cheryl was drunk and didn't know what was happening. She upset Gus, so he sent her to Germany. Benny was making up a story and it was hard for him to get it done quickly enough for Cheryl to believe him. But Cheryl really believed it.
Why didn't you say this before? Cheryl asked.
Benny said with embarrassment,
you were drunk and did not remember anything, so you forgot.
Cheryl breathed deeply a few times before she calmed herself down. She wanted to rush to question Gus. She knew she shouldn't. Then she said to Todd and Benny,
take me to see Rachel.
Cheryl, this...
Todd and Benny looked at Cheryl with some hesitation.
Take me to see her, she interrupted them.
Todd and Benny knew she was angry, so they quickly nodded. Todd went to Gus's office and Benny took Cheryl to see Rachel. Benny brought Cheryl to the Club Crimson. Cheryl followed him inside and asked,
Rachel is here.
Yes, she's locked in the basement of the Club Crimson, Benny replied. Cheryl followed him silently. He led her through the hall on the first level and then down a long corridor to a remote corner with an unmarked door. Benny took out a card from his pocket and scanned the keypad next to the door. The door opened. It was an elevator. They walked in and the elevator door closed, and they began to go downstairs. Cheryl did not know how many floors she went down. After about 2 minutes, the elevator opened with a clank. There was a long corridor outside. Benny led her through the corridor. Along the way, they walked past people who nodded to them and called them both by name. Cheryl didn't recognize any of them, but they all seemed to know her. She wasn't sure how. Cheryl could only smile and nod at them. When there were fewer people, Cheryl asked Benny curiously, why do they all know me?
Because they have all seen you, Benny replied.
Cheryl asked, when?
Benny did not answer Cheryl's question. Instead, he pointed at a room and said,
She is inside here, Benny said to the burly young man who was guarding outside the room. How has she been these past 2 days?
Not in a good mood, but I didn't cause any trouble, the man replied.
Benny nodded and signaled him to open the door. The man took out a key from his pocket, opened the door, and stepped aside. Benny and Cheryl walked in. Rachel was lying on the bed. Her arms were handcuffed to the sides of the bed, and she had a wrap around her mouth to keep her from yelling. When she saw Benny and Cheryl come in, she opened her eyes wide and tried to speak, but the sound was muffled. Benny walked over and took out the thing that was stuck in Rachel's mouth.
After Rachel's mouth was free, she shouted at Cheryl, "Impossible! Why aren't you dead yet?"
Cheryl was very angry. Otherwise, she would not have asked Benny to bring her here today. After hearing Rachel's words, she said with a cold face,
"I am not dead. Are you very disappointed?"
Rachel stared at Cheryl. Her expression was haggard and pained. She suddenly thought of something and asked,
"You are fine. But did something happen with Gus? I can't imagine he would let you come down here."
Seeing that Cheryl did not speak, Rachel knew that her guess was right.
"Oh, what a pity.
That man has put in so much effort for you because Jenna drugged you and he took his anger out on you." Just as Rachel finished speaking, Benny said with a cold face, "Shut up." Rachel looked at Cheryl meaningfully and did not speak. However, Cheryl had already heard Rachel's words. How could she let it go just like that?
"Drugged? What is she talking about?" Cheryl asked Benny.
Benny's eyes flashed and he replied, "Don't listen to her nonsense. There was no drug."
"Nonsense? Do you think you can still fool her?" Rachel said.
Cheryl asked Rachel, "Do you know what happened back then?"
"Cheryl, don't believe her," Benny said.
Before Cheryl turned to glare at him before he could finish, there was a sneer in Rachel's eyes as she said,
"On the day of the banquet, Jenna drank a glass of wine with you. She drugged the wine, and then you fainted in the bathroom. Then Jenna sent you to a man's bed." Cheryl did not expect this. Her body trembled. Rachel saw her reaction and was extremely pleased. She was unable to escape, but she was happy to see Cheryl in pain. Benny saw Cheryl's reaction and comforted her. "Gus rushed over to save you." Cheryl shook her head. She did not believe Benny's words. She turned around and ran out.
"Cheryl!" Benny was first stunned. Then he quickly chased after her. Behind them, Rachel's laughter could be heard. Benny's face was cold and solemn. He rushed out after her and quickly caught up.
"Nothing happened," he said to her.
Cheryl's eyes turned red.
"You saw it with your own eyes?"
Benny was not there at the time.
"You can ask Mark. He knows what happened and he was there."
Cheryl lowered her head silently and did not say anything. A moment later, Gus called. Benny answered the phone.
"I'm with Cheryl," Benny said. "I just need to take care of something. I'll bring her back to the office when we're done."
Gus didn't ask any more questions. He said okay and got off the phone. Benny was grateful that the conversation ended quickly. Gus was involved in the incident, but he had lost his memory. Benny hoped that Mark could help explain things to Cheryl. After Gus ended the call with Benny, he called Todd into the office. Todd had told him that Cheryl and Benny had gone out.
"Where did they go?" Gus asked.
Todd's heart skipped a beat when he heard Gus's words.
"I don't know," he said.
Gus's eyes were filled with danger. "Do you not know, or can you not tell me?"
Todd looked at Gus hesitantly. Gus said coldly, "Or do you want me to find someone to investigate?"
Todd quickly said, "Gus, don't investigate."
"Go ahead," Gus said.
Todd was silent for a few seconds. He told Gus what Cheryl had overheard. The things that Todd was describing seemed familiar, but Gus didn't have much memory of them. He frowned fiercely. He was frustrated by the gaps in his memory. When Todd saw Gus frown, he thought that Gus was very dissatisfied with what he and Benny did. He lowered his head and did not dare to say another word. Just when he thought Gus would lose his temper, Gus said,
"Let's go to the Club Crimson."
Huh? Todd didn't expect Gus to suggest this.
Huh? What? Let's go. Hurry up,
Gus said snappily.
Yes, Gus.
Benny and Cheryl had yet to learn that Gus was heading to the Club Crimson. Benny sat with Cheryl in the private room and waited for Mark, who arrived after about 30 minutes. He noticed Cheryl's sad expression first. He asked, Cheryl, what's wrong? Cheryl did not say anything. Mark looked at Benny.
What's going on? Where's Gus?
Gus is at the company, Benny said. I invited you here today because I wanted you to explain what happened with the drugged wine and Cheryl.
Mark did not expect Benny to contact him because of this. His mouth opened wide for a moment, and then he regained his composure.
Didn't Gus explain what happened? Mark asked. He glanced towards Cheryl.
She's heard some things, but she wants to confirm them with you, Benny said.
Confirm? Mark was stunned. Then he said, shouldn't we discuss this with Gus?
Because he misunderstood the divorce between Cheryl and Gus, he was now scared to death of Gus. He did not have the courage to tell Cheryl about the drugged wine.
Benny said, Cheryl can't ask Gus right now. She needs to know the truth from you.
Mark glanced at Cheryl, who did not look well. In the end, he threw caution to the wind. He said, okay, I will tell you what happened back then. That night, I was talking to someone when Gus found me. He couldn't find you, and he felt that something was wrong. He had called you and looked for you, but he couldn't find you. I started to help him search, but I looked through the entire banquet hall, and I didn't know where you were. Gus was extremely anxious. I decided to call the manager from the club. Then I went to the security room to look at the surveillance cameras. The footage showed you in the bathroom with Jenna, and then Jenna taking you away. We found her and made her bring us to you, and you were in a room with a man. Gus almost killed the man, beating him up, and you were unconscious on the bed. He took you to the hospital.
Benny looked at Cheryl, who had not said anything, and then asked,
Cheryl was fine when you went in, right?
She was drugged and was in a coma, Mark said.
Did Cheryl get...
Benny looked at Cheryl's face a little hesitantly. Mark was slightly stunned and replied, that shouldn't have happened, right?
It shouldn't have happened, right?
Benny looked at Mark meaningfully. Mark immediately realized what was going on.
I don't think so.
Unfortunately, Cheryl was already in despair. His words didn't help. And a moment later, they heard the door open and Gus entered the room. Todd, who was following behind him, gave Benny a meaningful look. Gus knew everything. It turned out that Gus had interrogated Todd, and he had explained everything that had happened between the two of them and Cheryl. Gus did not know what Benny was thinking. This moment, he was very dissatisfied. He was frustrated to see Mark there as well. Didn't Benny bring Cheryl to see Rachel? Why would this man be with them? Benny asked, Gus, why are you here? Gus did not answer Benny's question. He just reached out and grabbed Cheryl's hand. He pulled her up from the chair and stared coldly at Mark. The latter had a puzzled look on his face. Why was Gus looking at him like that? Did he know that he had told Cheryl about Jenna?
Gus.
Mark did not finish his sentence. Gus said coldly, didn't you and Benny come to see Rachel? Why is this man here? His voice was full with jealousy. As soon as he said this, the atmosphere in the room changed. Cheryl looked at him blankly, not knowing what he meant. Benny felt powerless when he saw Gus's jealousy.
Gus, this is Mark Vincent, Cheryl's cousin.
Gus glared at Benny and then changed the topic. Where is Rachel? Have you seen her? Cheryl frowned. Benny glanced at her and then asked, are you here to pick up Cheryl for dinner? But Gus was suspicious. Why would Benny bring up dinner right now? He felt like the rest of them were hiding something from him. His face darkened and he said, what is there that I cannot know?
There was something that happened before you lost your memory.
You didn't want us to bring it up, so we didn't speak about it, Benny replied.
Now I want you to talk, Gus said.
Benny pursed his lips. Cheryl said, Tell him.
Benny looked at Cheryl with hesitation.
Tell him, Cheryl repeated. Her tone was more serious this time. Benny sighed and then said,
Rachel told Cheryl that Jenna had drugged her and then sent her away with a man. So I called Mark to tell Cheryl about what had happened and whether that man touched her.
Hearing Benny's words, Gus recalled that he had asked Benny and the others to keep quiet about this matter to protect Cheryl. He turned his head to look at her. She was gazing at Mark.
I'm sorry to bother you with this, she said to Mark, and then stood up and walked out calmly.
She was already shocked by what Rachel said today. She had wanted to leave the club as soon as she heard, but Benny stopped her and called Mark to explain. Mark didn't even know what had happened, and now Gus had come as well. Cheryl felt so embarrassed by the entire situation. All she wanted to do was leave Club Crimson, and she left the room. When she walked out, Gus followed her. After Gus followed Cheryl out of the room, Mark asked Benny, What's going on? Why is Gus so strange?
Benny sighed and said, It's hard to explain.
Then he began to update on Gus's memory. Cheryl took the elevator up from the floor where they had met and left the building. She walked across the street. Gus was following her. Finally, she stopped and turned around and glared at him.
Why are you following me? She asked.
Gus looked at her for a few seconds and said,
I'm sorry.
I don't need you to be sorry, she replied. You chose not to tell me about this and to let me find out that this happened from Rachel, of all people.
Gus didn't say anything. He just looked at her. He regretted his actions. He was upset that he had kept this from Cheryl, and he also felt awkward that he had misinterpreted what was happening with Cheryl and Mark because his memory was lost. And he did not recall that they were related. He could have just asked Benny separately later and avoided this drama.
Cheryl was silent for a long time before she said,
You can go back. This has nothing to do with you.
But would Gus let Cheryl be alone here?
Of course not.
He reached out and grabbed Cheryl's hand, then pulled her to the side of the road, called for a taxi. Then he asked the taxi to take them to the best hotel nearby. Cheryl didn't understand what he was doing. Why did he want them to go to a hotel? She silently followed Gus and got out of the taxi when they arrived at the hotel. She followed him into the lobby and she stood at the front desk of the hotel, waiting for Gus to book a room. Then he took the key and entered the elevator. They arrived on the floor and Gus led the way to the room. He opened the door and she barely had a moment to look at what was around her before he picked her up and placed her on the bed.
What are you doing?
Before Cheryl could finish her sentence, Gus had already begun to kiss her. Later that night, Gus told her that he was going to call Benny to bring over a change of clothes for her. Cheryl, who was under the covers, said no.
Huh?
Gus turned to look at her in confusion. Cheryl said in a low voice, I don't want them to bring me new clothes. I'll just wear my old clothes. Asking Benny to bring new clothes would make it clear what happened between her and Gus that night. She didn't want anyone to know what was going on between them and that they had slept together again. Gus looked at her and said, Then you sleep. I'll go buy you an outfit.
Cheryl replied, No, that's really all right. Thank you. I can still wear my old clothes.
But Gus had made up his mind to buy her clothes. He said, Don't worry about it. Just rest. I'll be back soon. After taking two steps, Gus thought of something. He returned and kissed Cheryl on the forehead before leaving the room. Cheryl watched Gus leave. She lay on the bed and looked at the ceiling. Various thoughts ran through her mind. She knew Mark had not been able to tell her what happened in the room after Jenna drugged her. Only Gus would know. She was in despair. She felt confused and overwhelmed. So she had run away from Club Crimson. She did not expect Gus to chase after her. When she asked him to leave, he brought her to the hotel and slept with her.
At this moment, Cheryl had a revelation. Even if Gus did not remember her, so what? She could start over with him again. But as long as he was with her, it would stimulate his memories and cause him to be in unbearable pain. This thought made Cheryl hesitate again. Gus did not know that Cheryl was working through her thoughts in the hotel bed. He had arrived at the mall close to the hotel and was determined to find her an outfit. In the past, Gus had asked Benny to send over clothes for Cheryl, but he knew she would be embarrassed to have Benny or Todd get involved this time. Gus had picked out clothes for Cheryl on his own before, so he figured he could do so again. Even though he had an assistant purchase his own clothes, he felt comfortable selecting hers. He went to the mall and headed toward the maternity store on the 10th floor. When he walked into the store, everyone looked at him. He was an attractive man, and it was unusual to see a man in the store, especially such a handsome one. A saleswoman approached him. "Hi, can I help you with anything?" she asked. "I need to buy some maternity clothes," Gus said. "Okay, is this for your wife?" the woman replied. Gus did not feel anything was wrong when he heard others call Cheryl his wife. On the contrary, it made him feel very happy. Gus nodded. The clerk said, "Our store has several sets of pregnancy clothes." She brought out a few items. "She usually wears dresses," Gus said. The clerk nodded and asked, "May I ask which size your wife is wearing?" This was a little difficult for Gus. "I don't know." "How many months has your wife been pregnant for?" the sales girl asked. 3 months," Gus said. "And what type of build does she have? Is she slim?" "She's slim," Gus said. He suddenly realized that Cheryl was really thin. No one could tell at all that she was pregnant. The saleswoman went to collect some clothes and then brought out several outfits for Gus. He paid and walked out of the store with his bag. He was headed to the elevator when his phone rang. It was Benny. Gus paused for a moment and answered the call. "Hello?"
"Gus, where are you now?"
Benny asked anxiously. "At the mall. What's wrong?" Gus frowned and answered.
"Cheryl is gone,"
Benny paused and said.
"We can't find her anywhere."
"There's no need to find her," Gus replied.
"She's pregnant. What should we do if something happens to her? You don't have any memories of her right now, but if you remember..."
Benny continued. Gus's heart was beating very fast. He coldly interrupted Benny. "She is with me now." After saying this, Gus did not care what Benny's reaction was. He hung up the phone and returned to the hotel. When he passed by a restaurant, he turned around and went in again. He picked up some food for them, and then he returned to the hotel. When he went back, he found Cheryl lying on the bed. He thought that she was asleep, so he quietly placed the takeout on the coffee table. But she opened her eyes when he set the bag down. "You're back," she asked. Gus nodded and passed the bag of clothes to her. "You can try and see if it fits. If not, I can go return it." Cheryl nodded and sat up. Gus coughed lightly and said, "I'll set out the takeout. You can change your clothes and come to eat." Cheryl blushed and replied, "Okay." Gus turned away. She quickly sat up and changed her clothes. Then she went to the table. Gus looked up when she sat down and admired her dress. "Does it fit?" he asked. "Yes. Every time you pick my clothes, it fits," Cheryl replied. Sure enough, he had chosen clothes for her before. "Let's eat," he said. Cheryl sat down opposite him and started to eat. In the afternoon, when Benny and Todd came over to pick Gus and Cheryl up, they instantly realized that something was going on between the two of them. Gus was taking the initiative. Benny and Todd were very happy to see this. This meant that Gus and Cheryl had a better relationship. They were always worried about tensions between the two of them. Mary and Fred were afraid that Cheryl would let Gus recover his memory, so they had planned to attack her. They could see that their relationship was getting better, so they did not have time to waste. They hurried to make their arrangements. Cheryl accompanied Gus to work every afternoon. Every time the company's senior executives came to Gus's office to report to him, they would give Cheryl odd looks. This began to upset Cheryl, so Gus arranged for his secretary, Laura, to chat with her during these meetings. On this day, Cheryl sat in Laura's office, eating and chatting. They were talking in the office when someone came to ask Laura for assistance. Laura looked at Cheryl and wanted to refuse. "Sorry, I..." Cheryl took a plum candy from her pocket and put it in her mouth. Then she said to Laura, "Go ahead, do your work. I'm going to Gus's office." "See you later," Laura said. Cheryl nodded to the person who asked for Laura's help and then left the office. The man in Laura's office asked her, "Who was that person?" "She's with Gus," Laura said. The man was shocked by Laura's words. When Cheryl came out of Laura's office, she had planned to return to Gus's office. However, she found he was still in a meeting. So she left the office and went to the bathroom. Cheryl found an empty stall and went in. She locked the door and went to the bathroom. When she was done, she went to the sink and turned on the water and washed her hands. She walked over to the dryer and dried her hands, and then reached out to unlock the door. But as she opened it, she suddenly was pushed back into the wall. She thought someone might not realize that there was a person already in the bathroom. "One moment," she yelled. But instead of closing the door, a man entered the bathroom. Cheryl was stunned momentarily and then asked, "This is the female restroom. Why did you come in?" The other party did not reply, but grabbed her arm and covered her mouth with his other hand. After that, Cheryl felt something pressing against her back. The man leaned close to her ear and spoke in a low voice, "If you don't want to die, do as I say." She dared not move because she was afraid of hurting her child. She nodded repeatedly. "Drop your bag," the man said. Cheryl obediently threw the bag in her hand onto the ground. The man moved the knife that was pressed against Cheryl's waist to Cheryl's neck, and then passed a piece of clothing that he was holding to Cheryl. "Put on the clothes." Cheryl did not understand why she had to put on the clothes he was handing her. She looked at him blankly. "Do you want to die?" The man pressed the knife in his hand against Cheryl's throat. Cheryl felt a pain on her neck and some blood flowed out. She did not dare to hesitate and quickly took the clothes from the man's hands and put them on her body. When she was putting on the clothes, she took out a handful of plum candy from her pocket and quietly stuffed it into the pocket of the clothes she was wearing. Because she was pregnant, Cheryl liked eating sour plum-flavored treats. She always carried some with her. After putting on her clothes, the man gestured for Cheryl to follow him. When Cheryl came out of the bathroom and passed by the door, she quietly took out a candy from her pocket and threw it around the corner. She told Gus that she was out for a walk. If she did not return for a long time, he would definitely come out to find her. He would definitely look for her in the bathroom and see her bag. So Cheryl figured she could drop some of the candy as she walked so he would know where she had gone. She dropped a candy at the door of the bathroom and at the stairs and at the hallway that they walked down and then in the parking lot. Cheryl threw the last candy when she was forcefully pulled into the car. After she was brought into the car, she was tied up by the people waiting in the car. There was tape on her mouth. She couldn't move anything but her eyes. She looked around. There were three other people in the car besides the driver. There was the man who had taken her out of the bathroom, and then two other people. They stared at her. "Can we mess around with her?" one man asked. "Yeah, Adam, why not?" asked the other. They were talking to the man who had taken her out of the bathroom. Adam glared at them and said, "Don't mess around. You can't touch her. Otherwise, don't even think about getting the money." The men didn't say anything else, but they continued to stare at Cheryl. The windows were covered in the back, so she couldn't see where they were headed, but she knew that they had taken a right. She wasn't panicked, and she didn't feel terrified. She had already experienced too much. She endured the car accident, the kidnapping, and the flower pot. All she needed to do now was wait for Gus to come and save her. She believed that he would. Meanwhile, Gus sat behind his desk. reading the documents while listening to the report from the head of the finance department. He suddenly felt uneasy. Why would he feel uneasy? Was something terrible about to happen? Gus frowned. The head of the finance department, who was in the middle of reporting, suddenly saw Gus frown. He thought he had reported something wrong. He asked nervously, "Gus, I..." Before he could finish, Gus cut him off impatiently. Why did he feel uneasy? He had never felt this way. Gus suddenly thought of Cheryl. She had gone to Laura's office. Had something happened to her? Gus quickly got up from his office chair and headed outside. The finance minister, who had been left behind, had a baffled look on his face. What was Gus doing? After Gus rushed out of the office, he went straight to the secretary's office. There was no one in the secretary's office. His heart skipped a beat. As he walked out, he took his phone from his pocket and called Cheryl. She didn't answer the phone. Gus called her phone again and again. She didn't answer. Finally, he called Benny and asked him to find Laura. 5 minutes later, Benny called back.
"Laura said Cheryl went back to your office 10 minutes ago,"
Benny said. "Ask Laura to come to my office immediately. I have something to ask her," Gus said. Benny said that he would. Gus returned to his office and dismissed the finance director, who was still waiting in the office. He tried to call Cheryl again, but got no response. A few minutes later, Benny brought Laura into the office. "Are you sure she went back to my office 10 minutes ago?" he asked Laura. Laura shivered when Gus stared at her. "Someone came to ask for my help while Cheryl was in the office. I was going to say I was busy, but Cheryl said she would go to your office anyway."
"So you did not see her return to my office?" Gus asked.
"Well, she just left the room."
Gus pointed angrily at Laura and said, "I asked you to stay with her, and this is what you did."
Laura was so scared that she began to cry. She didn't reply.
"Gus, let's look for Cheryl first," Benny interjected. "We'll figure this out later." Gus nodded. "Ask everyone in the office if they've seen her recently."
Benny was very efficient. In less than 5 minutes, he got a report that someone had seen her enter the bathroom. They immediately went to the bathroom and began to knock on all the doors, but she wasn't there. But just as they were about to leave, Gus glimpsed a phone sitting on the sink. It looked like Cheryl's. He took out his phone and called her number, and the phone on the sink began to ring. Gus quickly walked over and picked up the phone. His name was displayed on the screen. Her phone was there. Where was she?
"Check the surveillance cameras," he said to Benny and Todd, who had joined them to look.
Benny and Todd nodded and walked out quickly. Gus followed. He had walked 2 steps when he saw something lying on the ground. It was the plum candy that Cheryl liked. She always carried some for her pregnancy cravings. He stood at the door of the bathroom and looked left and right. He looked toward the emergency exit, then he walked over. As soon as he arrived at the exit, he saw a candy around the corner. Her phone was in the bathroom. There was a candy at the entrance of the bathroom, and there was more candy at the emergency exit. It was all connected. It must not be a coincidence. Gus's heart suddenly sped up. He rushed into the stairs. He started to head downstairs, and sure enough, after running a few steps, he saw candy. He knew that he was going in the right direction. He kept rushing down. Probably because there was not enough candy, Cheryl had dropped the candy every few floors. Finally, Gus came to the parking lot. The parking lot was so big that he did not know where to start looking. His phone rang. It was Benny.
"Gus, we found the surveillance camera. Cheryl was carried out through the emergency exit."
Benny hesitated. Cheryl left with a man who carried her all the way. He was afraid that Gus would fly into a rage. However, Gus did not respond as angrily as Benny expected. "Was she kidnapped?" he asked. "Check the surveillance camera in the parking lot and see what car took her away."
"Yes, Gus."
While Benny and the others were checking the surveillance camera, Gus called the security guard of the company and started to look for candy in the parking lot. After a few minutes, one of the guards found a piece of candy in the area C of the parking lot. Gus called Benny to look at the surveillance footage from that section. Once they knew where she had been last, it was easy to find the car. "It was a black Audi," Benny said.
The license plate number is V863. After it came out of the parking lot, it went to the right. Call Mark to see if he can help track down the car, Gus said as he ran in the direction of his car. He opened the door and got in. He did not even bother to put on his seatbelt. He stepped hard on the accelerator. The car sped out. At the exit of the parking lot, he couldn't wait any longer. The bumper at the exit rose up. He rushed out, driving over the bumper. The guards saw him hit the bumper and talked among each other. "What's going on? Should we stop him?" one asked. "It's Gus," another responded. "It seems like someone has been kidnapped and he's trying to find them." Gus did not know that the security guards were talking about it. He was on a rampage on the road. His speed was even faster than racing cars. Fortunately, his car was not an ordinary commercial Porsche. It could go faster than anyone expected. Mark had sent him the tracking information for the Audi that he had found by using the surveillance cameras in the license plate. The car carrying Cheryl had already stopped. Cheryl was brought out of the car and realized they were in a rural place. There was a small house in front of him. Who had kidnapped her? Why did they bring her to such a place? Adam's phone rang and he answered it. "Hello. I've caught her. When are you coming over?" "A half hour." "Okay. Okay." After hanging up, Adam turned to the other three. "We have 30 minutes. Let's bring her up first." "Yes, Adam." They brought Cheryl into the house. It seemed to have been used for some sort of production because there were abandoned tools everywhere. From Adam's phone call, she guessed that he was hired by someone else to kidnap her. But who was it? She didn't offend anyone. But in the past, she hadn't offended anyone either, and still it had led to targeting. She didn't know if Gus found out that she was missing or not. Cheryl raised her hand and touched her lower abdomen. She sighed in her heart. "Baby, I hope your daddy can find what mommy threw earlier," she thought. About 30 minutes later, Adam's phone rang. After he answered the phone, he said to the other three, "The employer is already here. I'll go out and pick them up. You guys, keep an eye on her." A few minutes later, there was a knock on the door. "Adam is back. Hurry up and open the door," the men said. Cheryl turned to look in the direction of the door. She wanted to know who their employer was. The door opened. She heard Adam say, "The person is inside." "Why is she in such a dirty place?" said a woman's voice filled with disdain. Cheryl was very familiar with this voice. She opened her eyes wide in shock and stared in the direction of the door. Then she saw two familiar people come in from outside. They were Mary Monahan and Fred Tracy. These were Gus's parents. Cheryl wanted to speak, but her mouth was glued by the tape. Mary looked at her with disdain and then said to Adam, "Take the thing off her mouth." Adam removed the tape on Cheryl's mouth. Once Cheryl's mouth was free, and she immediately said, "Aunt, Uncle, why did you let them tie me up?" "Aunt, Uncle, what right do you have to call me that?" Mary glared at Cheryl as if she was dirt on the ground. Mary thought of herself as a noble royal person, but Cheryl was just a poor person. She believed that Cheryl was not at her level. Karina was on her level. "I know you do not like me, but if you do this, he will be angry," Cheryl said. Cheryl's intention of saying this was to make Mary stop, but Mary felt that she was using Gus to threaten her. Her face was cold as she said, "You actually dare to use Gus to threaten me?" "I am not," Cheryl shook her head. But Mary interrupted, "I do not care if you are or not. In any case, you have fallen into my hands now. It is fine, as long as he cannot recover his memories." Cheryl opened her eyes wide. "What do you mean? You don't want him to recover his memories?" Mary sneered. "He lost his memories, and that benefits me." "He is your son. And yet you would rather he suffer so you can benefit," Cheryl said. She looked at Mary and Fred in disbelief. "So what if he is our son? Mary said matter-of-factly. Then, in the next second, they heard a scream. Gus rushed in from the outside. Mary and Fred were terrified. Fred came to his senses and ordered Adam to grab Cheryl. Adam rushed to where Cheryl sat and pulled out a knife and held it to Cheryl's neck. "Gus, stop right there," Fred said. Gus stopped and looked at Adam, who was holding the knife on Cheryl's neck. "Let her go." Gus's voice was extremely cold. Adam's legs were trembling. He probably would have let Cheryl go if Fred and Mary were not there. He was intimidated by Gus. "Do you think we will let her go just because you demand?" Fred warned. Gus's eyes turned red when he saw Adam hold the knife against Cheryl's neck. Fred and Mary were delighted with his reaction. They said to Gus, "You can ask us to release this woman, but you have to agree to our conditions." Gus glared at them. "What conditions?" "We want 20% of the family shares," Fred answered. "You are really as greedy as always," Gus said with a cold smile. Mary and Fred's faces changed when they heard him. "You have 60% of the shares, so what if you give us 20%? Or is this woman not worth 20% of the shares? Sure enough, you don't have memories of this woman. She should be useless to you," Mary said unhappily. Cheryl's expression did not change. She quietly looked at Gus. Every time it was Gus who was protecting her. This time she did not want Gus to be restrained because of her. "Don't promise them," Cheryl shouted at Gus. Gus looked at her. Mary sneered. "Gus, what's your choice?" "His choice?" Gus suddenly remembered what Emma had told him a few days ago. She told him that Rachel's people kidnapped Emma and Wendy and Cheryl, and he chose Emma and Wendy instead of Cheryl. Today he had another choice. This time he would not choose wrong. He wanted to choose Cheryl. "I promise." However, before he could finish his words, he saw Cheryl suddenly move toward Adam. Adam did not expect Cheryl to move. He did not react in time. Cheryl knocked him away, but her neck was also cut by the dagger in his hand. Blood gushed out from her neck. Gus looked at the blood on Cheryl's neck. His eyes were red to the point of madness, scaring Mary and Fred into retreating. Gus kicked Adam's face with full force, and he rushed to Cheryl. He grabbed her, and his usually cold and emotionless handsome face was instantly filled with pain and anxiety. He shouted, "Call an ambulance!" "I'm fine. Just a little bit of blood," Cheryl said. She reached out and held his hand. Gus looked down at Cheryl's neck. "There's a lot of blood. You need to go to the hospital." "No need. You just need to get something to stop the bleeding," Cheryl said. Gus pulled off his shirt and tore it in half. He took a strip of cloth and pressed it to Cheryl's neck and carried her out of the house. He left Benny and Todd to deal with Mary and Fred and drove them to the apartment in Maple Court. Cheryl was surprised that he headed to Maple Court instead of their old house. He parked the car and carried her into the elevator. Cheryl realized that Gus had probably regained his memory. She did not want to watch Gus go through that kind of painful struggle again and again. But Emma said that long pain was not as short as short pain. She was kidnapped by Mary and Fred, and did her injury unexpectedly stimulate Gus's memories? Gus carried her to the door of her apartment and entered the password to her apartment. Cheryl was very sure that he had recovered his memory. However, she felt distraught that he must be hurting. After Gus placed her on the sofa, Cheryl asked, "Do you remember?" Gus's body stiffened and he replied, "I remember." Cheryl asked, "Do you have a headache? Emma can come to check on you." "I don't feel pain," Gus said. "That's good." Cheryl let out a sigh of relief. Gus's heart hurt even more when he saw her like this. "Why don't you blame me? I forgot about you and I still treated you that way," he said. Cheryl heard Gus's words and smiled. "Why should I blame you?
She reached out and held Gus's face, then put her lips close to him. Gus began to kiss her, but then Cheryl groaned in pain. Only then did Gus remember that Cheryl's neck was still injured. He let go of Cheryl and carefully examined the wound on her neck. "It's okay. It doesn't hurt," Cheryl comforted Gus. Gus did not say anything. He just found a medical kit and treated and bandaged the wound on Cheryl's neck. After wrapping it up, Gus hugged Cheryl tightly. He thought of Cheryl's painful look when he lost his memory. He could not help but feel pain in his heart. He said so many heartless words, but she never gave up on him. His fingers gently stroked the bandage wrapped around Cheryl's neck. Gus pressed his face against Cheryl's face. "I am so sorry." Emma came to check in on Gus and Cheryl to make sure that they were both okay. Only when she confirmed that Gus was fine did Cheryl truly relax. She was worried he was in pain. "Can you rest assured now?" Emma teased Cheryl. "Yes," Cheryl nodded and thanked Emma. "You can thank me by remarrying Gus," Emma said. Cheryl stared at her in shock. Emma saw the expression on her face and asked curiously, "What's wrong? Gus didn't mention marriage to you?" Cheryl shook her head. "He did mention it to me. I rejected him." "You refused to remarry Gus?" Emma looked at Cheryl in disbelief. "Don't you understand? He never wanted to divorce you. He just wanted to protect you." When Cheryl heard her words, her body trembled. Cheryl knew that so many things had happened to her. It was all because of Rachel. But she did not expect that the reason Gus agreed to divorce her was to have Rachel see that she was no longer involved with him, so that Cheryl could be protected. Emma continued, "Rachel had been watching you at that time. Gus was afraid that you would get hurt again, so he agreed to divorce you. He even reported it to everyone." Cheryl always thought that the reason Gus reported the divorce papers to the entire capital was to cut ties with the Doyle family. She did not expect that he was only trying to deceive Rachel. "Cheryl, you know Gus's identity. He's very involved with Dragon Gate. He's experienced danger many times before. But he's afraid. He's scared." Cheryl did not understand. Emma said, "Because he loves you too much. That's why he's afraid." "Love?" Cheryl was stunned. She shook her head. "No, he doesn't love me. What he loves is..." Cheryl looked at Emma and did not say the rest of her words. "What did you want to say?" Emma said. "Nothing." Cheryl shook her head and then said to Emma, "I'm sorry for troubling you. Thanks for your help." Emma felt that there was something hidden in Cheryl's words, but Cheryl changed the topic too quickly. She did not have time to react. "You are welcome. Keep an eye on your weight," Emma said. "You've lost some, but you should be eating more because of the baby." "I will," Cheryl said. After sending Emma off, Cheryl returned to the bedroom. Gus was leaning against the bed and talking on the phone. "They're messing around. Let them make a scene, as long as we watch them," he said into the phone. "Who was the they that they spoke of?" Cheryl wondered. She heard Gus say, "If they hurt Cheryl, they have to deal with the consequences." Cheryl immediately understood. The they mentioned by Gus was Mary and Fred. She frowned when she heard this. Even though they kidnapped her, they were Gus's parents. Cheryl couldn't help but speak up. "Gus?" Gus heard her voice and turned his head. He saw Cheryl standing behind him and looking at him as if she wanted to say something. He guessed that Cheryl had heard his phone call. He paused for a moment and said, "I'll call you later." Then he hung up. "You locked up Mary and the others?" Cheryl's tone was not a question, but a confirmation. Gus's expression did not change as he replied, "Yes, they are locked up." "Why are they locked up? Even if they kidnapped me, you can't treat them like this," Cheryl said. Gus's expression changed and became cold. Cheryl did not notice. "Your parents gave birth to you.
she thought to herself. You cannot treat them so ruthlessly. Even if they are wrong, you should not treat them like this.
Do you think I'm heartless? Gus asked.
No, that's not what I meant. I just want you to let them go. Cheryl wanted to explain, but Gus did not want to listen anymore. He turned around and walked out of the bedroom. This was the first time Gus treated Cheryl like this since the divorce. He didn't say anything and just left. Cheryl looked at his back. She felt lonely and sad, as if she had said the wrong thing. Gus didn't speak for the rest of the night, so she figured that she had said something wrong. But they were Gus's parents. She did not want him to be estranged from them because of her. She wanted Gus to not treat them like that. But Gus got angry when she mentioned this. Cheryl thought about it, but she could not understand why. In the end, she called Emma. Emma was Gus's adopted older sister. She should know what was going on with Gus. After Emma heard Cheryl's words, she was silent for a few seconds before she answered.
Gus and his parents don't have a good relationship,
Emma said. Why? Cheryl asked.
Neither does Gus's sister,
Emma continued. Cheryl had met Queenie, Gus's sister, at their wedding. Why are they not on good terms with their parents? Cheryl did not understand. Shouldn't parents and children be very close?
When she was young, her relationship with her mother was very good. After her mother passed away, Zachary brought her into the Doyle family. Initially, she had been full of expectations for her father. But because Zachary didn't like her and hated her, she had given up on all those expectations.
Even though she still thought that children would be close to their parents, the situation between her and Zachary was not like Gus and his parents. Why was there a bad relationship between them?
I don't know,
Emma said.
Why don't you call Queenie and ask?
Cheryl was a little hesitant. I don't know if that's a good idea.
Why not? She's the same to you as me. We're both your sister-in-law,
Emma said. Emma and Queenie were Gus's elder sister and Gus's younger sister. Cheryl was still a little hesitant. After all, she had only met Queenie once.
I can help you call her,
Emma said when Cheryl didn't reply for a bit. No need. I will call myself. Can you text me her number? Cheryl asked. After they got off the phone, Emma texted Cheryl Queenie's number, but she didn't call immediately. It was daytime, so it was night in Germany where Queenie lived. Cheryl was worried about disturbing Queenie. A few hours later, when Gus was looking at documents, Cheryl left the apartment and went to Sophie's apartment. The maid was surprised to see her. Cheryl, why are you here? Is something the matter? The maid asked. Nothing, I just came to make a phone call, Cheryl said. The maid felt it was strange. Why did she have to come over to make a phone call? But the maid did not ask any more questions. Cheryl dialed Queenie's number. Queenie answered very quickly.
Hello?
Hello, it's Cheryl, Cheryl said nervously. Queenie immediately said in a cheerful voice,
Hello, sister.
Hearing Queenie call her sister, Cheryl felt a little awkward. After all, she had already divorced Gus. She knew that Gus still liked her, but it still seemed odd. Gus and I are divorced. You don't need to call me sister, she said.
Even if you and Gus have divorced, you are pregnant with my nephew or niece, I'll still call you sister,
Queenie replied. Cheryl didn't have a response to that. Instead, she said, Queenie, I have something to ask you.
If you have anything to say, just ask. I will tell you everything,
Queenie said.
We are family.
Cheryl paused for a few seconds and then asked, Yesterday, Gus was unhappy.
Gus is a man. If he's unhappy, then so be it. Why do you care about that?
Queenie answered jokingly. Taking a deep breath, Cheryl said, I think it's my fault, but I don't know where my fault lies. He did not speak and was just gloomy all day, Queenie said. Oh. Then she said,
I'll call Gus later and ask him what's going on.
No, I called you to figure it out on my own, Cheryl replied. Mary and Fred kidnapped me, but I don't want them to be estranged from Gus.
They're your parents. But when I suggested that, he got upset and hasn't spoken since. I asked Emma about it, and she told me to ask you. Queenie was silent for a few seconds before she spoke.
Our family matters are a little complicated, she said.
Complicated? Cheryl did not quite understand.
How should I put it? The two of them were married, but they did not have any feelings for each other. When we were kids, they only used us to try and get money for support for us, but they didn't want anything to do with us, because we were their children from an unhappy marriage. And when we grew up and Gus became successful, they would contact only for money. When they want to talk to me, it's only to try to use me to get money through Gus. They are using everything, including my marriage. Gus finally lost his temper and cut off all of their finances.
Hearing Queenie's words, Cheryl suddenly remembered what Karina had said. They wanted to use her to get to his money. Yes, they said they wanted to use Karina, Cheryl said.
I heard about Karina. Those two also realized how important you are to Gus. That's why they kidnapped you and wanted to use you to get Gus's money,
Queenie said. The more Cheryl thought about it, the more depressed she felt. Cheryl's voice trembled as she thanked Queenie. I'm sorry, I didn't know about all of this.
You don't need to apologize to me,
Queenie said. But Cheryl felt guilty. I feel bad that I mentioned those things to him. After ending the call with Queenie, Cheryl just stood there. She really regretted that she had talked to Gus like this. What should she do to make Gus forgive her? Cheryl sat on the sofa in a daze, thinking about how to get Gus's forgiveness. Apologize to him? Cooking? Before Cheryl could think of a way, Gus came to her. The doorbell rang. The maid looked at Cheryl, who was sitting on the sofa, and got up to open the door. When she opened the door, she saw Gus. She paused for a moment and then greeted him respectfully. Gus nodded and asked, "Is she here?" "Yes, Cheryl is here." The maid let him in. Gus walked in and saw Cheryl sitting on the sofa. She was looking in the direction of the TV, but it was obvious that she was not watching it. Gus had already guessed that she would be like this after he received Queenie's call to tell him that she had spoken to Cheryl. Gus regretted that he had sulked and chosen not to speak to Cheryl instead of telling her the truth. When he got gloomy, she had turned to Emma for insight, and Emma told her to call Queenie, who had told her everything. Of course, Gus did not blame Queenie. After all, she did not know Cheryl would be like this when she heard the backstory. She did not know Cheryl's character, and how upset Cheryl would be to make him frustrated. She thought about it and then walked in front of Cheryl. When she saw Gus come over, she was first stunned, then said, "You, why are you here?" "I'm here to pick you up," Gus said. Cheryl looked at him but could not say anything. Gus reached out and held her hand. "Let's go back." Cheryl stared at him and held out her hand. After a few seconds, she stood up. She then followed Gus all the way back to the apartment. When Gus closed the door of the apartment, Cheryl finally spoke. "I'm sorry, I didn't understand anything." Gus did not say anything. He just looked at her. Panic appeared in Cheryl's heart. He had ignored her for a day. He had just discovered his memories, and he had just remembered her. In the end, he was angry again. Was he going to ignore her? "If you are not happy, then scold me. Don't ignore me," she said. Gus, who had been holding Cheryl's hand, suddenly let go of her hand. Was he angry and wanted to leave? Cheryl hurriedly reached out and grabbed Gus's sleeve. "I was wrong. Don't be angry." She was so anxious that tears streamed down her face. "It was not easy for you to recover your memories. It was not easy for you to remember me. Don't ignore me." Cheryl began to sob. Gus had already calmed down a long time ago. The reason why he did not speak was because he was thinking about how to tell Cheryl everything. Unexpectedly, Cheryl misunderstood and thought that he still ignored her. Gus began to tear up as well.
His heart ached as he took Cheryl into his embrace. "Don't cry. I'm not angry." Cheryl was stunned when she heard Gus's words. She slowly raised her head and looked at Gus. Her cautious look made Gus feel even more regretful. Why was he angry with her before? Cheryl stared at Gus's handsome face. Then she asked uncertainly, "Are you really not angry?" Gus lowered his head and looked at Cheryl. He paused for a moment and replied, "I regret how I responded. I shouldn't have been angry." Gus raised his hand and smoothed Cheryl's hair. Then he said, "I should have been more understanding that you didn't know any of the story about me and my family. It was reasonable for you to have questions." "But I still feel sorry," Cheryl said. Gus sighed and said, "No need. Queenie called me and said that you called her to ask about the matter between me and those two." Cheryl did not expect Queenie to call Gus back. She looked at Gus in a daze. He said, "Don't blame Queenie. She only called because she was afraid that something would happen between us." Before he could finish, Cheryl said, "I didn't blame her. I was just a little surprised." "Oh." Gus nodded and said, "She is very concerned about our relationship. If she was not pregnant and Chris would let her travel, she would have come long ago." Cheryl looked surprised by what Gus said. "You two have a good relationship," she said. Gus shook his head. "We've only started to have a good relationship in the past few years. We didn't before." "Why?" Cheryl looked at Gus, not understanding. Gus said, "I have to start with my parents. I rarely saw them, even when I was young. I thought that they wanted to see me, but they were just busy. When I was 4 or 5 years old, I was staying with John and Nancy, my godparents, and I heard that they were coming back, so I ran over to see them and skipped my classes. When I went over, they entered Godfather's office. I was afraid that John would find out, so I hid outside. It was winter and I was freezing. I waited outside for more than an hour before they came out. It had been so long since I'd seen them. I had only remembered seeing them in a photo. I was so excited I ran toward them, and Mary pushed me away and said, 'Where did this child come from?' And my father said with a cold face, 'Isn't it just a brat? Just shake him off and don't waste time.' My mother pushed me to the ground and left with my father. And when she walked away, she was complaining about John's office, how he needed to make sure that just any child or person wasn't allowed to hang around their building. I sat in the snow and watched them leave. Later, my godfather came out of the office and found me. I had already fainted from the cold. He saved my life." Cheryl couldn't imagine it. He was so small, and he was so excited to see his parents, and they deeply hurt him. Cheryl tightly hugged Gus's waist and said, "You have me. You have our child." "Yes, I have you," Gus nodded and said. Later, they had Queenie. Do you know why they gave birth to her? Because they had no money. They needed money. So if they had Queenie and then sent her to live with our godparents, they would get money to help support them. Then I finally began to understand that they had us just for money. They are not my family. My family is my godparents. After that, I started to work hard to learn from John how to become a qualified successor of his family and the master of the Dragon Gate. I put all my energy into studying. Gradually, I lost my feelings. Even when I faced Queenie, my sister, I was cold too. Everyone thinks that I am a cold-blooded animal without emotions. No, you are not. You are not, Cheryl said as she hugged him. Gus patted the back of Cheryl's hand and said, "I know. Don't be angry. I told you all this to let you know. I don't really care about them anymore. But I was always cold to Queenie until 6 years ago. They came back to find her and take her. And she begged John to help her and to help them.
She was so desperate for their love because I gave her none, and she was going to work with them. And so I realized I needed to open my heart up to Queenie. From then on, I learned how to get along with people. Cheryl could hear the regret in Gus's voice. His relationship with his sister had helped him begin to understand his feelings. The reason why I was angry with you was because they hurt you, but you were arguing that I should still have a relationship with them. Cheryl knew that she misunderstood Gus. Gus did not blame her. He felt that she should not speak for them after they kidnapped her. Cheryl said in a low voice, "I said that because I did not want to create tension between you and your parents." "Yes, I know." Now that Gus and Queenie had explained everything, there was no misunderstanding. But Cheryl did not ask Gus how he planned to deal with Mary and Fred. Previously, she felt that they were Gus's parents, and she could forgive them for kidnapping her. However, after knowing what they did to Gus, she could not forgive. So no matter what Gus intended to do, she did not intend to ask.
That's it for today, guys. If you want to inspire me more, you can buy me a puppy. Thank you for listening.